So up next, we have a panel for you. A growing trend that we're seeing within the sharing economy are communities that empower and foster those very values of sharing. On the panel we have next, we have some interesting participants. One created a very interesting community of experts. Another, two participants, in fact, bought a mountain for $40 million for their community. To moderate the panel, Zach Bell, the co-founder and COO of Share Practice, which is a collaborative clinical reference for doctors, will join on stage. So please welcome the panel on stage. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Zach, and I'm joined by Audrey from Summit, Ingrid from Pop Expert, and Natalie from Summit as well. So for those of you who don't know what Summit is, we're going to take a look at a quick video to check out the community.
Summit began with the idea that we can do better. We can build better businesses. We can be better environmental stewards. We can live better lives, personally and professionally.
I started a business, and I didn't know anyone who could assist, advise, or give me help in any of the different areas that I needed to grow the business. And so I had this idea, what if I called, out of the blue, people that I had always read about who'd become successful entrepreneurs, and what if we gathered all those folks in one place? From 19 entrepreneurs, 60 at the next event, 120, then 250, it just kept growing.
The only way I can kind of describe the kind of Summit community is kind of Camp David for innovators.
We have artists, we have astronauts, we have company founders, we have nonprofit leaders. It doesn't matter what your industry focus is, it just matters that you are innovating to create things that are going to improve the lives of others.
After just one four-day event each year, organizations were being created, tens of millions of dollars have been raised for nonprofits and business ventures.
You are making a difference today.
And we started to ask ourselves, what if we could build a permanent place where this community could gather all year round?
Now we have a permanent home here in Utah on 10,000 acres of Powder Mountain. We all feel driven to make this place better than when we got here. And when you gather people that all have that type of energy, regardless of their discipline, really incredible things happen. At Summit Eden, we'll build roads and homes. We love to see incredible businesses get started here. We want to see nonprofits that impact the world get their resources from the community. We want to see incredible music and beautiful art get created here. We look to create a platform and a community and a place that can empower this work. And the most exciting part is that this is just the beginning.
That's great. So, Natalie, you've been building the Summit community, and Summit's been building for about 5 years now, and Summit just purchased a mountain in Utah.
They did.
Can you tell me a little bit more about that?
Yeah. Hi, LeWeb. How are you guys doing in Europe? Thank you. A few rogue ones. So I'll give you a little taste of what it's like to enter into Summit or a Summit event. So if we could, we'll cue the lights. And I'm going to ask you guys to stand up. It's like the cheesiest thing in the world. I think Europe can handle it.
Let's do it.
We're techie. We're innovators. I'm going to actually ask you if you can give the person next to you a big hug.
Yeah. Oh, my brother. We really did it.
And the person on the other side, too. Don't be scared.
Oh, love you, Inky.
That's it. All right, we can sit down. Now we're friends. Now we can relax and have a conversation. Thank goodness. Whew. All right. So the landscape of entrepreneurship over the last 5 years has changed dramatically. And if you look back 5 years when we first started, I think there was a bit of loneliness that was in the hearts of entrepreneurs. We felt isolated. You know, we kind of were mavericks and rogue and didn't have a support network or a community. And so Summit started with a ski trip for 19 people. And it was this guy, Blake Mikowski, who had started this thing, Tom's Shoes, one for one, and they distributed a few thousand pairs. This other group, this philanthropy group out of San Diego called Invisible Children that was trying to take down Joseph Kony. And I think what people felt was an immediate sentiment of family and connectivity, that they weren't isolated or alone and trying to build their businesses. And so as Summit has grown, we've done, as many of you have heard, actually, I'll ask you guys again, how many of you guys have heard of Summit or Summit Series over the past? Good, okay. Now all of you, yeah. And so I think as the demand has grown, it was friends introducing friends to us. People just wanted to bring the other entrepreneurs that they knew, the other people that were doing really innovative and creative things to us. And in 2008, the Obama administration took over and they wanted to pick the brains of this growing community. And so we did an event there, pieced it together, made some rogue calls to administrators in the White House saying, why weren't you invited to this thing? And it became, we kind of hyped it up to be this internal, like, a really successful event. And Tony Hsieh, the founder of Zappos, was there, and he pulled us aside and he said, hey, are there people here that if they weren't successful, you wouldn't have had them at your event? You know, like, you wouldn't actually want to spend time with them. And we're like, yeah, there was a few. You know, but we thought it was important for the other entrepreneurs to meet them. And he said, yeah, you got to get rid of them. You can't have people who enforce social hierarchies. So in the history of Summit, it was the second component that we looked for building our community of entrepreneurs. One, are you doing incredibly innovative things? Great. Two, if we were stuck on a plane with you for 6 hours and it wasn't taking off and there were technical difficulties, would we actually enjoy the fact that we were sitting next to you? So those are the two things we ask ourselves. And Audrey and myself are two of seven curators. There came a moment in time where we didn't know how to scale. As entrepreneurship is just taking over and people are pursuing their potential through creating enterprises, businesses, philanthropies, scientific endeavors, we couldn't scale. Our events are around 750 people. And so we were really looking, the reason that we transitioned from a community building company that built community through events to now buying 10,000 acres is we want to just wrap our arms around a bigger community and allow it to happen more frequently. So I'll end it there. And with you knowing the vision for the place is that we'll be an epicenter for culture and innovation where things like this and dialogues and the people you're meeting today can actually happen every day if you want it to.
Oh.
That's amazing. So Ingrid, you're a member of the Summit community and been there for a while. What has a community that she's described, what's that done for you both personally and professionally?
Yeah, so I think I've been attending the event since the event in DC that Natalie mentioned. And just over the years, I've really seen this group of people that's passionate, committed, and more than anything, thinking about what it is they have to give and how they can support all the other people around them. The reason I think it's important to share that is because that's ultimately what the sharing economy is all about, in a way, is looking inward, figuring out what you have, whether that's assets or talent or whatever it might be, and thinking about how you can share it out with the world. With the business that I'm building right now, Pop Expert, a lot of it was actually inspired by that same ethos. How do you continue pushing yourself as an individual, learning new things that help you get better at life, work, and play? So meditation happens to be one of our most popular categories so far. It's something that I've done a lot with Summit friends, either at events or otherwise. Also thinking about how you foster stronger relationships is another thing that we focus on teaching. How do you incorporate hobbies into your life so that even if you're working very hard, you can still have a really balanced life where you also are continuing to grow and play and have fun? So I think that as I look at our business, this ethos that has been really cultivated by Summit is just such a huge part of it. And I believe in it so much, I actually bought into the mountain that they're buying here. So.
That's great. That's really, so you're the director of all things digital, is that right, at Summit?
That's right.
So tell me about the digital strategy of Summit a little bit. Like, how's the community seen in the tech world since?
Yeah, absolutely. So Summit has a very funny story. When I first joined,
It was this group of millennials and young people, and I thought that it was the dream job I had always wanted in digital. And I think the first day I was there, within 2 hours, everyone's like, well, what's Twitter? Why do we need to be on Twitter? And I thought, oh, wow, my work's cut out for me here. So I think the important crux of our digital strategy and what's relevant to this audience is that from the get-go, we thought, all right, we're going to share as much as we can as often as possible. We need to own our digital real estate and have a huge digital brand that kind of convenes the community of Summit. Ingrid, Zach, all these young people, we want to give them a platform to amplify their voices. Examples that we have to look at are TED and other super successful content providers who are incredible at capturing something on stage, putting it out on the internet, and having it go viral. What's important for us is that it became very clear, actually, that's not our duty. Our calling was to be the masters of the human experience and to curate offline experiences where a community was brought together. And if it becomes important that digitally we put those messages out on the internet, our time will come. Our coming of age will evolve. But for now, it's so important for us to focus offline at what we create for people to meet and build friendships and relationships ahead of business transactions. So what once was this quest for 200 million followers and being very effervescent on the web totally diverged. And I had to kind of take a slice of humble pie and say, oh, we need to listen to our brand and what our community is going to get the most out of. And that's not, frankly, us driving for followers, building a private social network. That's us curating salon dinners, doing things that bring them together in the flesh to enhance what the community is all about.
Mm-hmm. I think Audrey brings up a great point, which is, I think when you think of the concept of building new communities, you actually need to know like what endgame you're playing. Like, are you going for scale and numbers? Or are you going for quality and intimacy? And our strategy has been really focused on where are we actually, what are we actually driving and when? And for the most part, if you're in our walls of our events, I mean, we did a boat event. We had no internet. It totally failed. We were like, we did it on purpose, you know? And you've got to unplug. So, but it ended up being totally transformative and is now a key to our event. So I think it's knowing if you're building communities, what is your end goal? Is it scale? Is it numbers? Is it intimacy? And is it, the quality?
Absolutely. In addition, who can do it better, you or your community? We all know social and digital is about empowering people to democratically and independently organize their own pools of conversation and dialogue online. So if you're driving from a place of ego that you want to own that you want the followers, that you want to drive the message forward, you're probably doing yourself a disservice in some cases if you're an organization focused on community or one that should be. Our Facebook groups, unbelievable. I don't touch them. I don't want to touch them because they're so carefully driven and curated by the people who have built them and care about the conversation that's going on inside. In addition, that makes them the most volatile and full of conversation. Whether you want to find a new veterinarian or you're looking for a new developer, the entire Summit community will come in hordes with recommendations. And that's not something that we could have architected, that we could have seen and planned on our end. It happened totally organically through stuff that they curated.
That's amazing. So your reach is much bigger than you could have ever designed or strategized.
Totally, totally magnified.
So Summit grew exponentially over the last few years. Was there any strategy to grow it? Were there any plans to grow it? How did it get from where it was to where it is now? And
yeah, the best part about the community is it totally grew itself. Like, we literally started Summit, but it became really apparent that they owned it just as much as we did, which means we have a lot of people barking in our ear when they're upset. I think that we did two things really well. One, and there's a great book called The Thank You Economy by Gary Vaynerchuk, and he talks a lot about how you deal with a conversation around a certain topic and whether or not it's driven towards your profits or your consumer, that actually just being a part of the conversation is a part of it. I mean, we have this no asshole zone, no asshole rule. I said asshole, he looked up. And I think when people come in and I feel like they don't fit in under that role, like, we'll have a very direct conversation with them. So I think it's building something that is gravity in and of itself for the right type of community that you want to build. And the pace of it has just been something that the timing and the universe is right. And I don't know if you could scientifically break it down.
I think
yeah, please.
One thing I've noticed from participating that you've done very well is you've brought a great deal of humanity into the process of organizing and curating events. So going to a summit event doesn't feel like going to a conference in any way. It feels like you're actually going to a community and you're connecting with people. And as we look at LeWeb as a tech conference, I think that's also one trend that I'm really excited to see is that more and more companies, particularly in the sharing economy space, are starting to think about how do we approach technology in a way that really incorporates ideas of humanity, connection, giving. I think that's a trend that's going to be very powerful is we're each building these different businesses, looking at the offline models of what people want to do in the real world and figuring out how to infuse a technology layer underneath that to make it more effective.
We talk a lot about the technology world and the communities that we're building in the tech world, and you've touched on that. What can that do to drive a community in the real world? So how do you, digital versus analog, which comes first, which is better? How do you drive it?
I think it's situation specific which comes first, but I can speak specifically about Pop Expert as we're building it. So it's a marketplace for experts where you can learn new things like meditation, nutrition, through a face-to-face conversation over live video with somebody. And we could approach that from the perspective of thinking, oh, it's so cool, we can use technology to let people connect online. But what we actually really think about in our starting point is how are people meeting with experts in the real world when they're sitting down at a coffee shop or at a nutritionist's office or at their own home when they have somebody come visit them to teach them guitar. What is that experience like and what do people really like about it? And how do we create that within the digital space so that it's more efficient for the person that needs to spend their time learning or so that experts can reach a greater audience? But really starting with that perspective of how do people really do this in life versus what are the cool things that technology can enable, I think is a powerful starting point that can apply to all different types of businesses as we're thinking about building.
That's beautiful. So we're humanizing tech, finding
exactly,
the person
yes.
on the feed. So back to Summit a little bit. Summit bought a mountain, and we're seeing new ways of coming together and bringing people together. I mean, we're all here making connection. That's why we're all in this room today. Mm-hmm. Tell me a little bit about these new ways of bringing people together and new ways to convene.
Yeah, so I think for Summit, and I'd love Natalie to chime in on this as well, it's about diversifying your portfolio, so to speak, of how you bring people together. So for us, it was one annual conference where we bring people together, and it's this very surreal, almost Peter Pan setting where you're taken into a place where you're totally comfortable and your guard is down. And what we found is that people wanted that all year round, which is luckily why we ended up pursuing the opportunity of the mountain, to have permanent space, to architect a safe space where people that they can be, feel that they can be the truest version of themselves, but also talk about real business and social issues and things that matter in the world that have impact on the world. So for us, it's been a total combination of creating beautiful, smaller salon dinners throughout the year where we bring people together in different cities around the world, and finding those intimate moments where it's not just at a conference or on a Facebook group that you're bringing folks together, and generally in smaller groups, in settings where they can actually sit down and connect and it's not seeing 750 people over a three-day period and maybe running into someone once, but consecrated moments of really digging in with someone and getting deeper and having that intimacy.
Yeah, I'd say too, little pockets of gravity within some. So we're all here. I mean, you guys chose to come here to LeWeb in person. There's something that happens because you're here physically and getting context through that meme. And so I think this is a community right here. And then it's a matter of thinking about, well, if you want to connect with certain types of people here, how did LeWeb create empty space or a point of gravity that would naturally attract you to have those conversations? So we think really seriously about that, creating empty space for people that are craving a certain type of conversation, call it synchronicity, but we really drive that. And I think for us, for the Summit brand, there are three or four spaces that are integral to our experience. You have the common dining table. Audrey and I are serving you food that amazing chefs have cooked. You have an ashram, which is about yoga, getting away from the chaos of the extroverted crowd. And then there's a speakeasy performance space where, you know, for musicians to come in and inspire us through a creative way, or consequently content from some of the top entrepreneurs and intellectual minds coming in, it's like a learning and creative space. Like, those are integral for us. And so I think for other companies that are out there building communities, what space is it digitally or offline that you want to create that is just going to become gravity for the type of community you want to convene?
Absolutely. And how you set people up in those spaces. When you're having a dialogue, are people speaking at each other kind of aggressively or from a place of scarcity because they want to defend something? Or is it something in the round that really gets the energy flowing and allows for your consumers, your team, your employees to flow and to come up with productive solutions that literally the way you architect how someone is sitting is in a room could affect that?
So it's yoga, meditation, and communal dining, and hugs. These are not things that one would generally think to find innovation and these great companies being built out of. Why do you think it's at the least expected place? Mm. Why?
Ingrid, maybe you can take this one because you're creating a sharing platform and meditation's like all of a sudden the biggest, you know, your biggest vertical. So
which was a huge surprise to us, actually. We didn't know the world was so ready for meditation. But I mean, I think as you were both speaking, one of the things that really resonated for me was that you've intentionally or not created a very distinct set of values that's really diffused and embraced by the community. And they map to some of the things you're talking about, but a couple of the things that seem top of mind in my experience are really champion each other's successes. That's probably the most prominent and the thing you don't quite see as often within society is that positive value of supporting and championing other people. I think in a lot of ways our culture more broadly has moved to this place where on reality TV and in other sitcoms and everything, you start to see a lot of negativity and people getting excited about other people losing. It's the complete opposite in that environment, and I think it's part of what's drawn people to it so much is they feel like it's a safe space where I can be successful and other people are going to celebrate my success rather than feel threatened by it. And as we look toward the sharing economy and a lot of what's happening on the web, I think people are similarly responding in a positive manner to this idea of sharing and connecting, supporting and enabling other people, having other people help me pay my rent, as Joe mentioned earlier with Airbnb. So as we're all thinking about building our businesses, it's interesting to consider what are the core values that we want to cultivate as a company or as a platform, and then you have that in mind at the start, but then listening to your audience and seeing what really emerges from there, what's resonating, and how you can support the values that they're showing, that expressing that they would like, and really cultivate harnesses.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
So it's creating, I mean, what you touched on is a great point, is every business and with all of our marketing, we're creating a community around us. And so with the intention of creating a safe space for our customers or users or people that are touched, what's a safe space? Like what are characteristics of a safe space? What does that mean?
Yeah, totally. I'll kick it off. I think that when you are bringing people together, whether you're at a business conference, at a dinner party, at a friend's house, you want to create a space where they are encourage naturally, organically, to build friendships ahead of business transactions. So there's nothing to be lost on us that we all collaborate and work with people who care deeply about their businesses, about their exits and selling their company at some point. It's not just this hippy-dippy world. What's core to that, though, is that we can have a business transaction where I think, oh, cool, quid pro quo. Ingrid, what can I get out of you? Cool, you want to do a marketing campaign for like 3 months? Amazing. Over it, whatever. Or I can say, wow, Ingrid, based on everything that you did at building up to Pop Expert, as well as what you're building now, I actually think that for the next 5 years, the long play is going to be this. Mm-hmm. The long tail of what we can create is so much more exponential than something we might do in the next 3 months. So if you're creating a space where people care about that and they want to become friends first and build those solid relationships, the businesses that they build, the revenue that they drive, the impact that they drive in the world is going to be exponential. And it's really kind of limiting to actually play in that very aggressive transactional mindset. We're swapping business cards and that's the most.
Yeah, so. And to put a little more specifics around that, I mean, I can say it, so it's been a few years that I've been attending, participating in these events, and we just closed our angel financing round. We raised about $2 million. The vast majority of that support came from people that I met in one way or another through the Summit community, and it was never, I never intentionally went and pitched them with that in mind. I didn't ever ask for help from the Summit team, but it's just over the years of building these relationships, you end up having a great deal of trust, you have shared values and all of that, and you end up wanting to, again, celebrate and support each other's success. So I think that long view has very practically happened for us, and one of the hardest things that you do as an entrepreneur, which is raise money.
Yes, so true.
When you build a community that seems to be this strong and this powerful, what are, and as you're growing it, what are some of the metrics you use that you judge the success of the community off of?
Yeah, so that's a great question. It's something we chatted about a lot is, you know, if the sharing economy is an economy, a thank you economy, the gift economy, how do you actually measure success? What are the metrics that you use? I don't think that the economics out there, that we have these metrics that exist, but I think they're going to happen. There's going to be a whole vernacular, a whole language that develops around you being able to measure the success of your community. Right now, for us, it's stories like, it's accumulation of stories like Ingrid. Mm-hmm. And can we capture it all? No, not now. Do we have the language to map the single bonds and double bonds and the transactions that have occurred between those? No. But I think it's the reason that we're all sitting here, and it is, you know, on the edge of what's happening. I think there's really three factors that are coming together in a beautiful way for this entire concept of community building. It's the transparency that we cannot avoid. People are getting caught doing things they're trying to hide because of the web. And there are pictures from you when you're so young, you know, drinking a beer that may surface later. And I think that the transparency forces authenticity, not just for your brands, but your employees and yourself. The reason we do yoga and meditation at Summit is because I love it. And I'm one of the organizers, and I'm like, this is authentic. This is what we do in our spare time. So if you're coming to our house, if you're coming to our event, it's not just what we're doing for you, but it's authentically what we're experiencing on a daily basis. So I think transparency begets authenticity, and I totally forgot the other one, but yeah, that's where I'm at.
This idea of authenticity and sharing, I think also from a building a company perspective, we think a lot about how do we, as we're starting down this path of wanting to share our story with our early base of users, how do we do that in a way that's very authentic and transparent? And the simplest first attempt that we've made is to start recording incredibly organic, unscripted videos with particularly my co-founder and I, or members of the team, either thanking folks for their support or sharing stories of our experiences working with different experts. And the tendency from the perspective of a company is to want to do things in a very packaged, scripted way and make sure it's perfect. Our first video, I grabbed my co-founder and CTO, sat him down, said we have 5 minutes, and we want to just take a moment to reflect on what happened before we announced our funding. And it's not perfect by any means, but we got a lot of really incredible feedback from people saying, like, wow, it's so refreshing to see a company that is willing to just be open in this manner and to show kind of what's happening and let us be involved in the process. So I think as we're building sharing economy businesses, that's something to keep in mind. How do we be open and transparent and supportive, not just in the business construct itself, but also in our relationship as business founders or team members with the folks who are around us and supporting us.
Mm-hmm. So it seems like what I'm hearing from a lot of you is just dropping the business front and the transactional front and just becoming friends with your customers, your brand, just the people you do business with. It's phenomenal. So we're running a little bit low on time. As a lot of us out here are building sharing economy businesses and we're dabbling and learning what these things are, if we could take maybe one action or value into our brands that we build at home, what would that be? And I'll start with you.
Yeah, I think I talked a lot about authenticity, but I mean, if you like blazers, like wrap your brand in a blazer. Like, be authentic 100% with like who you are. I think the other thing is recognize that there is a total shift in relationships trumping a quick result. And people are, there's something about, I think, whatever is going on or with our generation, we're willing to play a longer game. we're doing yoga and meditation, we're doing these things that have cumulative results that are more about mastery and getting to something that is our end game as opposed to getting these quick quick hits and profits. So I would say that, you know, trust, if you're building community authentically from who you are, who your employees are, if you have a part of your company you want to project, hire somebody who embodies that. And so authenticity and then understanding like relationships over immediate profits.
So our business is all about inspiring people to continue learning and growing through life, to get better at life, work, and play. But I think in the most important thing that I want to summarize is really just that idea of infusing humanity into technology as we're building in every way you can, whether it's thinking about your market, your customers, your company relationship out to them, your employees. How do we do all of this in a much more human way than maybe we've been doing in the past?
Definitely. And I think that it's really important to understand that the psyche of this new generation of leaders and consumers has totally changed. The definition of success has totally changed. It's not as aspirational where you want the approval of the previous generation or leaders who are currently in power, but you want the esteem of your peers. For us at Summit, it is so exciting to have these two lovely people believe in what we do, as opposed to needing the press and other people to affirm it for us, because we really deeply care about them being proud of the product and community we're driving forward. A friend had just said this recently when we were doing a project with NPR, that you can't buy a movement. And what's really important about that is you can't buy a movement, you can't buy a community. There's no new app that's going to make millennials care about radio. What there is, however, is the power for public media and other big players to build community around fulfillment and that new aspiration of wanting to push the world forward and have this esteem of your peers. And that's what's going to draw our generation into your brand, your product, or your content. And so that shift in psyche is really important.
I'm excited to see the communities that get built. Thank you very much for being here.
Thank you. Thanks, guys. Thank you.